Who was Snorri Sturluson? Snorri was born into the wealthy and powerful family Sturlungar in Vamur in Iceland in 1179. His parents were Sturla Thordarson and Gunthni Bodadottir. Snorri also had two brothers and two sisters and nine half-siblings. Snorri was raised from the age of 3 or 4 by John Lofsson, who was a relative of the Norwegian royal family in Oddi, Iceland. The reason why he was not raised by his own parents was because of a settlement in court called Alting. His father Sturla had settled a lawsuit with the priest and chieftain Pal Sulvason. Pal's wife Torbjörg Bjarnadottir had attacked him with a knife and said she wanted to take his right eye so he would look like his one-eyed hero, Odin. Sturla had been lucky. The bystander had deflected the blow, so he was only cut on the cheek. The settlement in Alting would have bankrupted Pal, but John Lofsson intervened in the Alting to mitigate the judgment. To compensate Sturla, he offered to raise and educate his son Snorri. Because of this, Snorri received an excellent education and made connections that he might not have otherwise made. Snorri got married in 1199 at the age of 21 with Herdis, the daughter of Bersi Vamundarson, a very wealthy family. From her father, Snorri inherited an estate and a chieftainship. Snorri was soon after acquire more property and chieftainships. Snorri and his wife had two children together, Hallbera and John, but the marriage would not last very long, and they got divorced in 1206. Snorri settled in Reykholt in an estate where he made significant improvements, including an outdoor hot tub called Snorralav. During his time at Reykholt, he fathered 5 more children with 3 different women. Snorri would also marry his children into unhappily marriages, which would further enhance his political goals and make him more powerful. Snorri was fat and loved to sit and soak for hours in his hot tub with a cup of ale in his hand. He was in fact a heavy drinker. Snorri was the wealthiest man in Iceland, and he knew the laws by heart, and he was clever and cunning. Snorri used his political powers to benefit himself and his own family, but mostly himself. In 1215, Snorri became a law speaker of the Alting, the only public office in the Icelandic Commonwealth, and a position of high respect. In the summer of 1218, he got a royal invitation, so he quit his job as a law speaker and sailed to Norway. Here he met the king of Norway, Hakon Hakonsson, who was only 14 years old. 2 years later, Snorri was given the title of baron in 1220 by the king of Norway, and he was showered with gifts, and in return, Snorri wrote poetry about them. In 1220, Snorri returned to Iceland, and in 1222 he became a law speaker of the Alting again, which he held until 1232. His fame as a poet helped Snorri in being elected for this position. In 1224, Snorri and the widow Halvi Ormsdottir became a couple. She was a granddaughter of John Lofsson. Snorri became the most powerful chieftain in Iceland during the years of 1224 and 1230. Shortly after he had written his last book, Snorri was killed because he had betrayed the Icelandic chieftains by selling out the independence of Iceland to the king of Norway. But Snorri had also betrayed the king when Skuli, who was a pretender to the Norwegian throne, had offered him to make him a Jarl of Iceland. After Skuli's death, Geysir had become the king of Norway's new favorite chieftain. Geysir had received a letter from the king that said Snorri was a traitor. The king had ordered Geysir to capture Snorri and send him back to Norway, or to kill him. But Geysir decided to wait. In June 1241, when Helvig died of sickness, Snorri went into a depression and it seemed that he has lost interest in everything. Helvig's children asked Snorri for half of his stuff, as if the couple had been married. He said that he would only share everything that was in the East, which was what Helvig had brought into the relationship, but also half of his money and valuables. But the two children was not happy about this deal, so they went to Geysir to complain about it. This turned out to be the excuse that Geysir had been waiting for. Geysir gathered support from other chieftains around Iceland, and in the late night of September the 22nd, Geysir and 70 men rode up to Snorri's house. Kulban's army of 400 blocked the road to the north, and another chieftain's army blocked the road to the west. Geysir and his men went into Reykholt unopposed and broke into Snorri's house. The noise from the splintering wood from knocking in the door must have awoken Snorri. He stumbled out of bed and into a storage room in his house. Here he was trapped, and he hid behind some barrels while he could hear the wind howling outside in the dark and cold night. An old fat man like Snorri would not get far in just his nightshirt. While Geysir's men went from room to room searching for Snorri, Geysir asked the priest where Snorri was. If the priest told them where Snorri was or not, doesn't matter, because moments later they found Snorri. The captain said to one of his men, "Strike him down." "Don't strike," said Snorri. "Strike, don't strike." The man struck, and so did another, and another, and Snorri collapsed on the floor. Snorri Sturluson was dead. We have much to be grateful for. Snorri helped us preserve our myths, even though he wrote them from a Christian viewpoint, because Snorri was a Christian. Some of the masterpieces that Snorri Sturluson has written is the Prose Edda, also called Snorri's Edda, Himkrisgla, and Egil's Saga. There's a link to the translations of this book in the description. This video will unfortunately be the last one in the Norse mythology series. But just for now, don't worry, I will make more Norse mythology videos in the future. The reason for this is because I want to focus on the sagas, which will be on Sundays. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. And if you haven't already, press that subscribe button. And see you next time. Thank you for watching.